Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of This Just In, What I Couldn't Tell You on TV. Written and narrated by Bob Schieffer. This work is copyrighted 2003 by Bob Schieffer. This recording is copyrighted 2002 by Recorded Books. Bob Schieffer, anchor and moderator of Face the Nation, has been at CBS News since 1969. He is one of the few correspondents to have covered the four major Washington beats, the White House, Pentagon, State Department, and Capitol Hill. He is now CBS's chief Washington correspondent. And now, This Just In.
Chapter 1, Oswald's Mother. In those days, I was the night police reporter at the Fort Worth Star-Telegram, the newspaper in the town where I grew up. I was 26 years old, made $115 a week, and worked the late trick, 6 p.m. to 2:30 a.m. I hung out with cops, emergency room nurses, barmaids, and other creatures of the night. Like most young reporters who covered crime, I considered myself a superb investigator, more cop than journalist. I wore a snap-brim hat, hoping I'd be mistaken for a detective, and when someone made that mistake, I never corrected him. The stories I covered were an endless series of car wrecks and murders, the hours were awful, the pay was low, even by Texas newspaper standards, and I thought it was about the best job anyone could ever have. But when I heard that President Kennedy was coming to Fort Worth, I wasn't entirely happy about it. In those days, presidents didn't travel nearly as much as they do now, so it was big news for my hometown, but bad news for me. Kennedy's visit would cause no interruption in my regular schedule. The political reporters would handle Kennedy. They would not need any help from me. For a reporter, there is nothing worse than being in the middle of a big story that someone else is covering, and I was more than a little irritated. Kennedy and his entourage flew into Fort Worth late on a Thursday evening and, assignment or no assignment, once we put the paper to bed early Friday morning, I hustled over to the press club, which was being held open after hours to accommodate the traveling White House press corps. The party was well underway when I got there around 2 a.m., and for me this was as good as it got. There I was, chatting up reporters I had known only by their bylines. Merriman Smith of UPI, Tom Wicker of the New York Times, Bob Pierpoint of CBS, and a dozen more. Kennedy had come to Texas to heal some quarrels in the Democratic Party and to raise money for the 64 campaign, and the tour had started in Houston and San Antonio. After a Thursday night speech in Houston, he had flown to Fort Worth to spend the night and attend an early morning Chamber of Commerce breakfast before taking a 10-minute flight to Dallas for a parade and luncheon speech. The tour was to end with a huge fundraising dinner in Austin. Governor John Conley had convinced Kennedy that only in Austin, the state capital, could you count on getting people from the rest of the state to come to a fundraiser. People from Houston wouldn't go to San Antonio for a fundraiser, Conley told Kennedy, and people from Fort Worth damn sure wouldn't go to Dallas. He was right about that. When Amon Carter was running the Star-Telegram, he made a point of taking a sack lunch when he had business in Dallas, claiming he did not care for the city's restaurants. Dallas repaid the courtesy when Fort Worth built an airport between the two cities and named it Carter Field. Dallas residents declined to use the airport, in large part because of the name, and the airport eventually failed. There was and is such a rivalry between the two cities that the only project they ever cooperated on is the current airport. Planners were careful not to name it after anyone from either city. The visiting reporters had no interest in airports, of course. What they did want to know about was a local after-hours joint called the Cellar. The Cellar had no liquor license, but if you were a friend of the owner, a former stock car racer named Pat Kirkwood, the drink of choice, Kool-Aid, was spiked with grain alcohol, and it was on the house. It was not the drinks, but the fact that the Cellar's waitresses wore only their underwear that had given the place some notoriety, and the notoriety had apparently spread as far as Washington. Hippies and free love would descend on San Francisco, and Kirkwood always claimed his place was the forerunner of what was to come. Whatever the case, Phil Record, the Star-Telegram Night City editor, and I were appointed to guide our visitors to it. It seemed like a good idea at the time and must have been quite an evening. I remember we stayed long enough for some of the Easterners to see their first Fort Worth sunrise. A group of off-duty Secret Service agents joined us, and in months to come there would be congressional hearings into whether the visit had left them as alert as they should have been the next day in Dallas. Having no assignment the next day, I could afford to sleep late, which was my normal practice anyway. I was the oldest of three children, and my father had died when I was in college, so I still lived in my mother's house, helping her to make a home for my brother Tom and my sister Sharon. Tom had been 10 when Dad died, and Sharon 15. But by the time Kennedy came to Texas, Tom was in high school, and it was Tom who shook me awake shouting, "Kennedy has been shot. You'd better get to work." Tom had been allowed to miss school that day, and he and Mother had driven into town early to see the president as he emerged from the Chamber of Commerce breakfast. As Kennedy walked out of the Texas hotel and toward his car, Tom had been one of the last people in Fort Worth to shake his hand. Within hours and before they had returned home, Kennedy had been shot. I dressed as quickly as I could, grabbed my black felt snap-brimmed Dick Tracy hat, and roared off in my two-seater Triumph TR4 sports car. As I parked in the lot near the Star-Telegram office, the radio confirmed the worst. The president was dead. It was as if someone had hit me with a hammer. At once, I was stunned, hurt, and embarrassed. Stunned because such violence was unthinkable in those days. Hurt and embarrassed because it had happened in my home state. Why did something like this have to happen, and why did it have to happen in Texas? As I made my way inside, lines of people two and three across were already surrounding the Star-Telegram building. The Kennedy assassination would be the first story that the entire nation would watch together on television, and because of it, television would soon replace newspapers as the place where most Americans got their news. But when Kennedy was shot, people still really didn't believe the news unless they saw it written down in black and white. So hundreds waited outside the Star-Telegram for the special editions that rolled off the presses. "The truth was we couldn't print them fast enough," said one of our editors. "People would stand in line to buy one edition, then go to the back of the line to buy a copy of the next one." They were the last of the great newspaper extras, and they would come to symbolize the end of the newspaper era. Inside the city room, it was bedlam. When the flash that Kennedy had been shot had hit the wires, an editor had dispatched so many reporters to Dallas that there was no one left on the city desk to answer the phones, and they were all ringing. Nonetheless, one of the editors told me to get to the police station. A man carrying a load of dynamite in his car had been arrested leaving Dallas County and was being brought to the Fort Worth jail. He was the best suspect so far in the Kennedy shooting. I managed to get to the police station just as he was being brought down the back stairs. Early in my police reporting days, I learned a trick from the cops. People will sometimes blurt out the truth if they're surprised by the question. So I jumped in front of the handcuffed suspect who was between two detectives and shouted, "You son of a bitch, why did you do it?" "Well, I didn't," he said, as the cops hustled him into the lockup. In a matter of hours, it would become clear that the poor man had done nothing and knew no more about the assassination than the rest of us. He had stopped for gas at a service station between Dallas and Fort Worth and mentioned to the attendant what he had heard on the radio, that the president had been shot. The attendant hadn't heard about it and called the cops, figuring the only person who could have known about the shooting was the one who had done it. When police stopped the man's car and found the trunk loaded with dynamite, it was enough for them too. As the afternoon wore on, it was determined that the man was exactly who he said he was, a demolition contractor who was en route to a construction job. Had it happened today, it would have triggered dozens of lawsuits against the city and the police, and at least the threat of one against me. But the police apologized, and the man said no problem, and went on his way. When I got back to the city room, the confusion was worse than ever. By now, a dozen Star Telegram reporters were on the scene in Dallas, but when they called in, there was no one on the city desk to answer the phones and take down the stories they were trying to call in. I hadn't even removed my hat when I settled behind a typewriter and picked up one of the ringing phones. In all my years as a reporter, I would never again take a call like that one. A woman's voice asked if we could spare anyone to give her a ride to Dallas. "Lady," I said, "this is not a taxi, and besides, the president has been shot." "I know," she said. "They think my son is the one who shot him." It was the mother of Lee Harvey Oswald, and she had heard on the radio of her son's arrest. "Where do you live?" I blurted out. "I'll be right over to get you." Why she called the Star Telegram that day remains a mystery. She had lived a vagabond life during most of Oswald's childhood, but she had eventually settled in Fort Worth, and when Oswald had defected to the Soviet Union, Star Telegram reporters had interviewed her. We would also later learn that just a week before the assassination, she had been working as a governess in the home of Star Telegram founder Amon Carter's son. The family had had no idea she was the mother of a defector, but had discharged her because the children complained that she was mean. Whether those connections prompted her call, we never knew, nor did I know any of that as I began to think about how I was going to get her to Dallas. Somehow, taking her there in a two-seater open sports car just didn't seem quite right. Which led me to the desk of Bill Foster, the paper's automotive editor. For years, local car dealers had furnished the auto editor with a new car and gas to fuel it. It was offered and accepted without embarrassment, with the understanding that the auto editor would road test the car and write up the results in his Sunday column. Not surprisingly, the reviews were usually favorable. When Bill told me he was driving a Cadillac sedan that week, I said, "Come on, I'll explain as we go, and you're going to like it." We found Mrs. Oswald on the lawn of a small home on Fort Worth's west side. She was a short, round-faced woman in enormous black horn-rimmed glasses and a white nurse's uniform. She carried a small blue travel bag. I got in the back seat with her, and Bill drove. She was distraught, but in an odd way. I would later come to believe she was mentally deranged, but for most of the trip, she seemed less concerned with the death of the president and for her son than with herself. She railed about how Oswald's Russian-born wife would get sympathy while no one would remember the mother, and that she would probably starve. I marked it off to understandable emotional overload, and I couldn't bring myself to use her self-serving remarks in the story I filed later that day. I probably should have. She would later be so brazen as to tell a reporter for Life magazine that Mama wants money. And years later, she was still saying the same things. As she had predicted, the world showed her little sympathy, and she supported herself in the end by selling Oswald's clothing to souvenir hunters. The drive to Dallas took about an hour, and when we reached the police station, Bill let us out and said he would join us later once he had parked the car. Hundreds of reporters had converged on the station, most of them in a hallway where the detective offices were located. Since I was wearing the Dick Tracy hat, it was easy for me to pass for a plainclothesman. There was a uniformed cop behind a counter in one of the offices, so I approached him and said, "I'm the one who brought Oswald's mother over from Fort Worth. Is there some place she can stay where she won't be bothered by all these reporters?" The officer guided us to a small space that seemed to be some kind of interrogation room and said, "How about this?" I said thanks, settled Mrs. Oswald in, and went into the hallway to see if I could help our guys. By then, there were 17 of us on the scene, but the problem was finding phones to call in what we had found out. Other reporters were having to walk several blocks to find phones. I began to gather up what our team had collected and called it in from the office the police had given to Mrs. Oswald and me. Never once did anyone ask me who I was. As the evening wore on, Oswald's wife was brought to the police station, and an officer asked me if we would mind if they let her share the room. I told him I saw no problem. The only difficulty for me was that she seemed to speak no English, only Russian. Toward dark, Oswald's mother asked Detective Captain Will Fritz if they could visit Oswald. Fritz agreed and led us into a holding room below the jail. The group included Oswald's wife, his mother, an FBI agent, and me. I couldn't believe it. Oswald was being brought down from his cell. I would soon be face to face with the man who was being charged with killing our president. Whatever Oswald said, this would be the story of a lifetime. An exclusive interview with a man who had just been charged with killing the president. We had only been there a few minutes, but to me it seemed an eternity, and I could feel my heart beginning to beat faster when the FBI agent casually asked, "And who are you with?" I had watched veteran interrogators bluff their way with a suspect by answering a question with a question, and in my best imitation I sort of half-snarled, "Well, who are you with?" The agent seemed a little edgy now. "Are you a reporter?" Now I was really pushing it. "Well, aren't you?" It was at this point that I believe I received my first official death threat. The embarrassed agent said he would kill me if he ever saw me again. Or at least, that seemed to be what he was saying. I was already leaving as he said it. It would be the biggest story I almost got but didn't. And I went back to the crowded corridor and blended in with the rest of the reporters. For the next 2 days, I would just be part of the crowd. That night, I had dinner at one of Dallas's largest steakhouses with Roger Summers, another Star-Telegram reporter, and except for a man and woman at another table, the restaurant was empty. My interview with Mrs. Oswald came too late for the Friday evening extra, but it made the Saturday morning paper, and I spent that Saturday at Dealey Plaza, where Kennedy had been shot. Hundreds of people had gathered there, the nation was in shock, and nowhere was it more obvious than in the plaza where he had been shot. People seemed to wander aimlessly, occasionally talking to anyone who happened by. Some left flowers, some just stared. I talked to one man who had come to Dallas to see Kennedy, but had seen only a motorcade racing toward a hospital after the shooting. It was as if he had lost a friend. He could not understand how it could have happened. His grief became the heart of a story that I filed for the Sunday paper, a story that began, "Today I walked with a man named Gregory Pontes, and for a moment, he seemed to speak for all America. I've written thousands of stories since that day, but I never forgot the lead to that one." Oswald was still being held in the police station, but was to be transferred to county jail the next morning to await trial. We had begun to scale back our coverage, and our photographers were sent home. One of the reporters would watch Oswald as he was brought out of the city jail and placed in a car for the trip to the county jail nearby. I was to watch him arrive there. It was a trip he would never make. As two detectives brought him to the loading dock, the man we would later know as Jack Ruby walked from the crowd of reporters and onlookers, stuck a small pistol in Oswald's side, and killed him. How could it happen? I have been asked that question many times, and when I explain that this was a different time, the answer seldom seems to suffice. But those were the days before metal detectors, identification cards, and concrete barriers, all the security precautions that we have come to accept as a part of modern life. America was yet to be scarred by the violent acts that led to the security checks. We didn't shoot our presidents, we didn't know much about terrorists, and the only people who used bombs were gangsters, and as long as they confined their killings to each other, we really didn't mind. In those days, if you looked as if you belonged, you could usually get in most places. I had walked into the Dallas police station and secured the use of an office on the strength of nothing more than wearing a hat that made me look like a detective. Ruby had been a hanger-on at the police station. Because he looked as if he belonged there, no one questioned his presence. For the reporters Oswald's shooting meant, it was time to go back to work. Our managing editor, Lauren McMullen, decided to put out a Sunday afternoon extra, something that had never been done. This was no simple task. When the paper had churned out those extras the day Kennedy was shot, the presses were already rolling with a complete newspaper that only needed to be updated. McMullen was talking about starting from scratch, a complete newspaper including want ads to be on the streets early Sunday afternoon. Somehow, McMullen and his team of editors managed to do it. We were so proud of the accomplishment that when the first copies were trucked over from Fort Worth, I grabbed a bundle and sold them myself at Dealey Plaza. I guess I still owe the paper some money. I don't remember turning in my profits, but in truth, I gave away more papers than I sold. It was a sweet scoop. We had managed to get our papers to Dallas before the Dallas Morning News had printed its first edition, and it was even sweeter because McMullen had found a way around having no photo of the shooting. The Dallas paper had a graphic shot of Ruby just as he rammed the gun into Oswald's stomach and had moved it as a copyrighted photo on the Associated Press wire shortly after the shooting. McMullen grabbed it off the wire, blew it up, and spread it across the front page. Beneath the photo in 6-point agate type, the tiny type used in baseball box scores, was the line, "Copyright 1963, Dallas Morning News." We had beaten the Dallas News to the streets of Dallas with a paper's own photo. Newsweek and Time picked up my quotes from Mrs. Oswald and both sent me checks for $50. And later that week, I got a phone call from Dan Rather, the young CBS News reporter who had flown in to cover the story. He was trying to reach Mrs. Oswald and wondered if I might have her phone number. I didn't, but I gave him her address. It was the beginning of a friendship that would last more than 30 years, but the information proved to be of no help. A New York-based Life magazine reporter named Thomas Thompson, who had also happened to be from Fort Worth, had managed to put the Oswald women under exclusive contract to his magazine and had secreted them away in a Dallas hotel. My brief quotes from Marguerite Oswald would be her only comments to appear in print for weeks. I was sent back to Dallas the next week to cover the funeral of J.D. Tippett, the policeman that Oswald had killed as he fled the Texas School Book Depository. As hundreds of police officers from all over America paid their last respects to Tippett, Oswald was being buried quietly in Fort Worth. Fearing violence, officials gave no public notice of the Oswald funeral. His mother, wife, and brother attended, but there were not enough people to act as pallbearers, so three Star-Telegram reporters, John McConnell, Jerry Flemons, and Ed Horn, helped the funeral home workers carry the casket. It would not be until weeks later that I realized the emotional toll those days had taken on me. I have heard of people who experienced traumatic events that left them so drained of all emotion, they were unable to feel pain. But for me, the overpowering shock of trying to work in the midst of it left me so exhausted mentally that for a while, I somehow became immune to emotion. Several nights later, back on the police beat, I was in the emergency room of St. Joseph Hospital when the bodies of a family that had been fatally injured in a car wreck were wheeled by on gurneys. They had been beheaded when their car had slammed into the rear of a truck loaded with metal pipes. A police reporter sees many sights, and death and injury were nothing new to me. But only after I had watched the bodies pass by did I realize the sight had provoked no reaction at all. It was as if I had no emotion left to express. It would take me a long time to get over those days, but I would not be the only one. That day in Dallas would be a turning point for America. It was the first time that virtually the entire nation had come together to witness and share a national tragedy, and we had shared it on television. The scenes of that week, the killing of Oswald, and the hour upon hour of the live coverage of Kennedy's funeral, the cortege, the black-veiled young widow, the dead president's tiny son saluting the flag. All those sad pictures would be burned into the national psyche. No more would Americans have to see something written down in the newspaper to believe it. For the first time, Americans were seeing what the reporters saw. No longer would they have to wait to read what the reporters had written about it. From then on, they would compare their own observations to those of the reporters. From that day on, it would be the imprimatur of television that made events official. The change in the way Americans thought about the presidency and the men who occupied it would be even more profound than the shift from newspapers to television, as the medium most Americans now turn to for news. Before Dallas, we had come to believe our presidents were somehow invincible. It was not so much that we considered them bulletproof, but it was inconceivable that someone would try to kill a president, or even want to. Presidents had bodyguards, to be sure, but they rode in open cars and mingled freely with people. After Dallas, all that would change, and because they seemed more vulnerable, we would no longer see the invincibility of the office itself in the same way. The next four decades would bring great change to America, but none more dramatic than the changes that would come to pass in journalism and politics. America lost its innocence that day in Dallas, and we would never look at government and our politicians in the same way. As a young newspaper man in those days when most Americans got their news from newspapers, I saw it begin to happen that day in Dallas. Later in Vietnam, I saw the awful war that caused many young Americans to lose all faith in government and our leaders. As a network television correspondent in Washington, I would see the nation's confidence in government and the media shattered even further. I would see other national leaders cut down in their prime, another president shot, and still another survive impeachment. And I would finally see the country come together once more after the terrorist attacks in 2001. I got to see most of it and came to know many of the major figures of those four decades because I am a reporter. I became a reporter because I always wanted to see things for myself and make my own judgments about them. The lucky thing for me was that I found people to pay me for doing it, and it is what I have done over and over at CBS News in more than 10,000 interviews, stories, special reports, and radio and television reports, as well as in thousands of newspaper articles. Those events I covered have become part of our history, and you already know most of them. But I want to tell you about the parts that didn't get on television or in the paper, the serious parts and the not-so-serious parts, the good times I had and the presidents, senators, correspondents, big-time crooks, and small-time swindlers I came to know in the four decades since that day in Dallas. Here are the stories I tell my friends, and they're the stories I want to share with you. Chapter 2, The Johnson City Windmill. When my daughters were young, they loved to ask me if I wanted to be a TV reporter when I was a little boy, and they always giggled when I told them there was no TV when I was a little boy. We didn't have a TV until I was in the eighth grade. A world without television was so incomprehensible to them, they would ask me the question over and over, as children do when they want to hear the same bedtime stories because they love the endings. I have come to understand their disbelief. Television has become such an overwhelming part of our culture, it's sometimes hard for me to believe there was a world before the tube and that I was a part of it. But even in those long ago days, before I knew about television, I knew that I wanted to be a reporter who covered politics. I can't pinpoint when I decided on journalism, but like so many of a certain age who grew up in Texas, my political awareness, my starting point for politics, was Lyndon Johnson. In the years after World War II and on into the 1960s, Johnson didn't just dominate Texas politics, he was Texas politics. His name was attached to everything that came from Washington, whether it was money for a highway or a new contract for the defense plant on the edge of Fort Worth. He was the giver of all good things, the defender against those who would take away from Texas, and he was the first politician I ever saw. The year was 1948. Harry Truman was campaigning across the country by train, and that fall he would score his famous upset over Tom Dewey. But if you were 11 years old and living in Fort Worth, Truman and Dewey were just names. We weren't thinking much about presidential politics that summer. From daylight to dark, all we thought about was baseball. There was no Little League. We organized our own games, and that's how we heard about Johnson. Word spread through the neighborhood that he was coming to the vacant lot where we played ball, so we all went down to see him. Several hundred people had already gathered there when we arrived, and all at once we heard this great whirring noise, and there was this thing in the sky, an airplane with no wings, the helicopter that would become known that summer as the Johnson City Windmill. This would be tame stuff for today's little leaguers, but we'd never seen a helicopter or anything like this, and from out of the sky we heard this booming voice. "This is your candidate for the United States Senate, Lyndon B. Johnson, and I'll be down there to talk to you in just a minute. Go tell all your neighbors." We didn't go tell anyone. We were transfixed in terror. As Moses must have felt when he realized the burning bush was speaking to him, we didn't know what to think. God, Lyndon Johnson, whoever it was, we were frozen in awe or fear or just frozen as we watched this contraption make its way to the ground and shut down its engines. As the dust settled, the helicopter doors opened, and there he was, Lyndon Johnson, who remains in my memory to this day as the most imposing man I ever saw. I have no idea what Johnson said that day, but everyone clapped and hollered, and as he turned to board the helicopter, he grabbed the Stetson cowboy hat he was wearing and threw it into the crowd. And then he was gone, up, up and away like Superman. We just stood there. It took us a while to believe what we had just seen. Even the grown-ups were amazed. Many years later, I told this story to longtime Texas Congressman Jake Pickle, who said, "Oh, I know all about it. My job was to catch the hat." Johnson campaigned all over Texas that summer, sometimes making as many as 16 stops a day. As Pickle told it, he had been a young volunteer in the campaign, and his main job was to be in place at each rally site before Johnson's helicopter landed. He would position himself in the front of the crowd as Johnson spoke, so that when Johnson threw his hat, Pickle was in place to catch it. "It was all worked out in advance," he said. "Lyndon wasn't about to throw away a hat. He was too tight. He'd throw the hat to me, and I would run around to the other side of the helicopter and put it on board. If I didn't get back there in time, I'd have to drive like the dickens to the next stop to give it to him there, and if I didn't make it, he'd start asking people where the hell his hat was." The national political reporters in 1948 wrote most of their stories about Truman's whistle-stop campaign by train. But in Texas, Lyndon Johnson's every move was what we wanted to know about. The rest of the campaign, I checked the Fort Worth Star-Telegram every day to see where that helicopter was. Johnson went on to win the election in a runoff, but it was a race that would haunt him all his political life. Out of 1 million votes cast, he won by a mere 87. And then, only after a bundle of ballots that had gone uncounted turned up several days later. If the voter registration rolls were to be believed, 200 of the people who had cast the newly found ballots had voted in alphabetical order, and many of them appeared to have the same handwriting. This mysterious action was never explained, and his opponents claimed the election had been stolen. But we were too young to understand any of that. We just remembered Johnson and the helicopter and the day he came to our neighborhood. As we came of age, Johnson was as much a part of our culture as the Alamo, and we couldn't imagine politics without him. From the day I saw Johnson, I was hooked on politics. The journalism part would take a little doing. In junior high, I served as sports editor of the school newspaper, did the same in high school, and was also editor-in-chief of the yearbook. So my friends assumed I would be a reporter of some kind. But it was an assumption my mother did not share. She was a child of the Depression, and to her generation, it was the mother who spoke of my son the doctor, who was considered the real success. So it was that when I enrolled as a freshman at Texas Christian University in Fort Worth, I declared my major to be pre-med. I'd been an A student in high school, but I had no interest in science or the healing arts, and it was soon apparent they had no interest in me, or any other student who refused to study and thought a biology test could be aced with a little creative writing. Thus, when students ask me today how I got into journalism, I usually give them the truth. Comparative anatomy made me do it. After fooling around with pre-med for 2 years, I switched my major to journalism, and I never regretted it. My plan was to become a newspaper reporter. Even then, I had no plan to get into television. For one thing, my first try at TV had been a total disaster. During high school, I had been invited to participate in a student talent show broadcast every Saturday on the local NBC affiliate. The host was a young college student named Pat Boone. Boone would soon record a song called Hearts Made of Stone and go on to stardom. My career, it is fair to say, stalled. The show was sponsored by Foremost Milk, and Boone emceed it from behind a soda fountain. I was to give the commercial, which required me to pour myself a glass of milk, take a sip, smile, and say, "That Foremost Milk is sure good." I did it perfectly, except to say, "That Vandervoort's milk is sure good," which did not please the Foremost people, since Vandervoort's was their chief rival. I was never asked back until many years later, when I became the station's news anchor. But I digress. A week after I switched my major to journalism at TCU, a student named Bruce Neal told me he had just gone to work at a small radio station and that there might be an opening for another reporter there. 2 days later, I got my first paying job as a reporter, working the night shift in the news department of KXOL, a 5,000-watt radio station. At night, KXOL carried the games of our minor league baseball team, the Fort Worth Cats. The play-by-play man was Bill Hightower, an old NBC staff announcer who doubled as news director. I went to see Hightower. The station was across the street from Farrington Field, the high school football stadium. Hightower took me to the station's front door and asked me what I saw. "A football stadium," I replied. "No," he said, "give me a word picture of what you see." I remember babbling on to the effect that it was big and gray. It still looked like a football field to me, but my words seemed good enough for Hightower, and I got the job after assuring him I could type. I couldn't, but I learned in a day, proving a variation of Sam Snead's old adage about golf. If you don't know how to putt, play for $100 a putt. You'll learn soon enough. Moral: we learn what we need to learn when we need to learn it. The job paid the grand sum of $1 an hour and featured an overtime payment system that, as far as I know, remains unique to this day. We received 90 cents for the first hour of overtime, 80 cents for the next hour, 70 cents for the hour after that, and so on. If you worked 10 hours overtime, that last hour was worth a dime. None of that mattered. I was to be paid for being a reporter, and it was big stuff for a 20-year-old kid. I went to school in the mornings and worked a split shift at the station, 1 p.m. to 4 p.m., followed by a 4-hour break and then a return to the station for another 4-hour shift from 8 p.m. to midnight. It left little time for study, which was excuse enough not to. Miraculously, my grades did improve after I went to work, and even with a switch in majors, I was able to take extra courses and graduate on time, if not with honors. In reality, college life for me ended the day I went to work. I wanted nothing from the university but the degree. I put little into it and got little in return. I have always been a voracious reader. Books are my greatest pleasure, and I have since read most of the books I should have read in college, so I consider myself largely self-educated. My great regret is that I never gave college a chance, and it took many years for me to realize what I had missed. In those days, I just didn't have time for it. I was too busy being a reporter. It was what I had always wanted to do, and I was being paid to do it. Radio was in transition in the late 1950s. The programs that we had grown up with, Bob Hope, Burns and Allen, Your Hit Parade, had all moved to television, and radio was groping to fill the void, not always with success. Local stations no longer wanted network programming. Station managers discovered they could build bigger audiences with a new format that featured music and local news. KXOL was a top 40 station. Over and over, the disc jockeys played the same 40 most popular rock and roll records. On the hour and half hour, those of us in the news department read a 5-minute newscast, but only when we weren't out covering what we came to call the three R's: wrecks, rapes, and robberies. We monitored police radios constantly, and when we heard of a convenience store robbery or a car wreck, when police radio identified wrecks as signal twos, that meant injuries, we raced to the scene in brightly painted panel trucks that we call mobile units. We left the disc jockeys to read the newscast while we reported on the latest calamity by two-way radio from the scene. Our reports were preceded by a recorded ambulance siren that the disc jockey played as he switched to us. We signed off by reminding our listeners that KXOL was the station that pioneered and developed on-the-scene news coverage in the Great Southwest. Well, perhaps one of the stations that pioneered such coverage would have been more accurate, but we probably should have also added the station that had turned its news department over to three college students who knew nothing about reporting but were being paid $1 an hour for the chance to learn. News director Hightower soon moved to a higher-paying job in the sales department, which meant the station that pioneered and developed on-the-scene news coverage in the Great Southwest had a news department staffed entirely by students. Me, Roy Eaton, who later became a newspaper publisher and remains a lifelong friend, and the late Bruce Neal, who went on to become one of the area's most successful public relations executives. Bruce had been the student who had led me to the job. Of the three of us, he had the most experience and was the only one of us old enough to buy beer. In truth, we had no idea what we were doing, but we learned by doing it, over and over, which is the best way to learn reporting. And if we were inexperienced, we weren't about to tell it. The second week on the job, I was covering a horrible auto accident on a county road northeast of Fort Worth. With no hesitation, I described it on the air as the worst accident I have seen in all my experience as a reporter. Some weeks later, my experience would be challenged when I heard the police radio alert that an East Fort Worth night spot called the Penguin Club had been bombed. Fort Worth was a fairly wide-open town in those days. Gangsters were always ambushing one another, and the explosion had all the earmarks of an underworld hit. I raced to the scene in the mobile unit, but a uniformed cop stopped me at the door of the bombed-out building and asked for identification. I proudly flashed my new press card. "Sorry," the cop said, "I need to see your driver's license or something with your date of birth on it. This is a beer joint. Nobody gets in here unless they're 21. I didn't even bother to show him the license. I was only 20, the only reporter I ever heard of who was carded at a gangland bombing. Surely there was a First Amendment issue there somewhere. For a kid who wasn't old enough to buy beer, chasing wrecks and robberies was far more exciting than sitting in a college classroom. It was a seamy side of the world, to be sure, a world of cops and crooks and various lowlifes of the night. But I loved it. I just liked being where the news was, knowing about it before other people did and telling them about it before someone else could. What I remember most about those days are the rookie mistakes I wanted to forget at the time. Walking into a death scene and asking in my most official voice, "Where's the body?" only to discover I was standing in it. A shotgun suicide can spread a body over most of any room. Or the time I followed the cops to a lake outside town where they had been tipped that another of our gangsters had been buried by his killers. It was a fairly routine crime story, except the part where I accidentally stepped backward into the grave. The cops could not have been more pleased, but the smell was so overpowering I didn't even try to wash it off my pants. I just threw them away. If we learn by our mistakes, I was learning a lot. I've always believed the police beat to be the best training ground at any news organization, for the simple reason that wherever the police reporter goes, he is not wanted. He's always intruding on someone who is probably experiencing the worst moment of his or her life. Police reporters show up at tragedies and no one wants them there. Contrast that to the sports writer, who is welcomed wherever he goes, except the losing team's locker room or in the presence of the spoiled multi-million-dollar athlete who's in a slump. Even so, the sports writer is usually given the best seat in the house, free food if he chooses, and help if he asks. People run when they see police reporters, and the police reporter must use his wits to get even the bare facts. If a young reporter can learn to do his job in a businesslike way in the circumstances a police reporter finds himself, he can do his job anywhere. The only thing I didn't like about KXOL was the wife of station manager Earl Fletcher. It wasn't that I didn't like her personally, but she couldn't pronounce Schieffer. So Fletcher decreed that I should be called Schaefer. Go figure. At school, I was Schieffer. At work, I was Schaefer. Schieffer or Schaefer, the 2 years until graduation passed quickly. Between crime stories, I covered everything from the opening of the new toll road between Fort Worth and Dallas to an unscheduled visit from Louisiana's erratic governor, Earl Long. Long would later gain national notoriety when he had a torrid and very public affair with stripper Blaze Starr. We trailed Long around Fort Worth for several days, but never quite got his reason for dropping in. We had been tipped he was coming, and when he stepped from the plane at the old Carter Field, we knew this was no ordinary visit. He had removed the pillowcase from one of the plane's pillows, cut eye holes in it, and pulled it over his head. Atop all this, he was wearing a Western hat. "I wish to remain anonymous," he announced grandly, and said later he had only come to buy some watermelons. After several days, he left, and we still didn't understand why he'd come, except that he was crazy. I had graduated earlier that summer, and the long visit was the last story I would cover before heading to Travis Air Force Base, north of San Francisco. Because I had been in the ROTC, I owed the Air Force 3 years of active duty. It was a pleasant interlude for me, and once again Lyndon Johnson would be part of my life. Not long after he and Kennedy took office, he passed through Travis en route to Asia and a goodwill tour. During refueling, he left his plane to shake hands with the military people who had come out to see him, and when he got to me, I told him I had been born in Austin. He ordered one of our base photographers to take our picture, and it was such a fine shot, I had a dozen copies printed. I sent one to my mom and took the liberty of signing another to Bob, good friend and fine officer, all the best from his friend, LBJ. It looked terrific on my desk, and I kept it there throughout my 3-year tour of duty. No officer who outranked me ever commented on it, but I noticed more than one giving it the eye. It really was a fine photograph. These were the days of the Cold War, civil defense shelters, and the Sino-Soviet threat. But as I headed to the Air Force, none of that bothered me much. We had been living with a nuclear buildup and the threat of nuclear war for so long since the early days of the Eisenhower administration that we seldom thought of it. As it must be with Californians who know they live with the constant threat of earthquakes, we couldn't bring ourselves to believe nuclear war would ever come. Nor would I ever see or hear a shot fired in anger during my Air Force years. Like many Cold Warriors of the day, I flew what we call the LSD, the large steel desk. And I spent most of my time editing Air Force publications and serving as a public information officer. It was not until my assignment was all but completed that the Cold War interfered with what had been, for me, a chance to travel the world and, for the first time in my life, live alone outside my mother's house. I was to finish my 3 years of active duty in early September, but that summer a mysterious Soviet buildup appeared to be underway in Cuba, and those of us due to be released were told we might be frozen, that is, kept on active duty, until whatever the trouble was had passed. Not until the last week in August did I get word I would be released on time. A friend at the Seattle Post-Intelligencer, a newspaper I had dealt with as a public information officer at McCord Air Force Base, offered me a job as the paper's real estate editor, an offer I politely declined. KXOL had saved a job for me back home, and the day the Air Force issued its final and official thanks for my service, I headed back to Texas. It took me 3 hard days of driving, but I was back in Fort Worth on a Sunday night and reported for work at KXOL on Monday morning, stipulating only one condition: no more Schieffer. This time I would be Schieffer. An hour into my first day back, it was as if I had never been away. Same wrecks, same robberies, and I couldn't wait to start covering them. Chapter 3, Mississippi Burning. The summer and fall of 1962 was a dangerous time, more dangerous than those of us who had come of age during the Cold War had realized. Kennedy had almost gone to war with the Soviet Union over Berlin, and the situation remained so tenuous that as I was driving back to Texas in late September, Kennedy's Secretary of Defense, Robert McNamara, issued yet another warning to the Soviets. If war came over Berlin, the United States was prepared to use nuclear weapons. And now there was a Soviet buildup in Cuba. The young officers at my level had no idea of the scope of it, but the notification that we might be held on active duty beyond our scheduled release date was more than enough to get our attention. What I had not understood as I drove home that September was the intensity that was building in the civil rights movement. Military people lead a somewhat cloistered life, and during the 3 years I spent on West Coast air bases, the civil rights demonstrations were something we saw only on television. Montgomery, Alabama was a long way from San Francisco and Tacoma, Washington, where I had spent the last 3 years, and the demonstrations neither touched our lives nor did they provoke much comment at the Air Force bases where I was stationed. To be sure, I thought of myself as someone who believed in equality. My mother had been somewhat ahead of her time for Texas. As the child of a poor family growing up during the Depression, she had known what it meant to be different, even if the difference was that your clothes were not as fine as those of your schoolmates. And she taught us that all people were to be treated with courtesy, The word nigger was still so commonly used in Texas that when dispatchers broadcast alerts on the police radio, they routinely described black suspects as young nigger males. But it was not a term used at our house. My mother thought the people who talked that way only showed their ignorance. We were told the polite terms for black people were colored or negro, which usually came out nigra because of the southern tendency to substitute an ah sound for words that end in a hard O. In college, I had also come to believe in integration, which put me at odds with some of my contemporaries, but I considered myself an enlightened person. In truth, I hadn't given racial questions much thought. I had gone to segregated schools, ate in segregated restaurants, and went to segregated movie houses. When I read my hometown newspaper, the Fort Worth Star-Telegram, I read only about white people. The paper took notice of Negroes only when they were arrested for crimes against whites. White women were referred to in the newspaper as Mrs. or Miss. In the rare instances when black women got their names in the paper, they were given no title but were referred to as the Jones woman or the Smith woman. Male Negroes were never referred to as Mr. It was easy for me to say I never had a problem with Negroes. I didn't know any, with the exception of the occasional housekeeper that my mother hired to help with spring cleaning. They lived on their side of town. We lived on ours. The only time we really ever saw them in groups larger than two or three was on June 19th, called Juneteenth, the anniversary of the day the slaves in Texas learned they had been emancipated by Lincoln. On Juneteenth, Negroes were allowed to use the Fort Worth parks and visit the zoo. As a child, I can remember driving through the park with my parents and hearing them comment on what a nice thing it was that the colored people were being allowed to use the park on their holiday. It never occurred to us that they might feel shortchanged, since their taxes helped pay for the park, just as ours did. It was not until I was in the Air Force and shook hands with a black sergeant that it occurred to me I had never shaken a black hand. It wasn't that I had anything against it. The opportunity had never presented itself. Like many young white men and women in Texas, we thought of people in the Deep South as the ones who hated Negroes. We had no problems with Negroes because we seldom came in contact with them. Somehow, we never got around to asking why. After the Supreme Court ruled on Brown versus Board of Education, Fort Worth adopted a stair-step plan starting at the lower grades to integrate its schools. But since the neighborhoods were strictly segregated, blacks continued to go to black schools and whites to the schools they had always attended. It was some years after I had graduated from college that any black person could say he or she had attended any school that I had attended. As it was in most communities across the Sun Belt, we knew changes were coming, but the Negroes did not push for action, and Fort Worth remained as it had always been. It would be well into the 70s before schools, movie theaters, restaurants, and other public places were truly integrated, and when it happened quietly and without incident. Across the Deep South, the situation was far different. The Freedom Rides had begun in the summer of 1961. These stories did not always get the play in our newspapers that they did in the East, but the week I returned to Fort Worth, the papers were filled with stories about Edwin Walker, a retired right-wing army general from Dallas, who had been arrested for trying to raise an army of white militia to block integration at the University of Mississippi. Acting on orders from a federal court, U.S. Marshals had tried four times to enroll a young black man named James Meredith there, only to be turned back by mobs that had numbered 2,500 at one point. Not much had changed in my hometown, but one thing that was different was little KXOL. It had become a real news organization. Roy and Bruce had enlarged the staff, raised reporters' pay to respectable levels, and the station had begun to win awards. The staff of disc jockeys who spun the records had also enlarged. Rod Roddy, who went on to become the announcer on The Price is Right on television, had joined the announcing staff, as did a young George Carlin, who was just beginning to put together a stand-up comedy act. Station manager Earl Fletcher thought it unseemly for one of his disc jockeys to be working after hours in nightclubs and fired him. In any case, the place where Roy and Bruce and I played radio as college students had become a station people respected and depended on for news. No longer did we cover just the wrecks. Bruce had established a beat covering City Hall, and my main job would be to cover trials and county government. Still, I was a little surprised the station had begun to take its commitment to news so seriously that Roy told Bruce to fly to Mississippi and cover Meredith's enrollment at Ole Miss. The next day, I was even more stunned when Roy told me to take one of the mobile units to Oxford and help him. By now, the wire service tickers were clicking out a steady stream of reports from Mississippi, and there was little doubt that the situation was becoming serious. Playing to the crowds, Mississippi's Governor Ross Barnett vowed never to allow Meredith to enroll. As a group of white U.S. Marshals approached him during one attempt to enroll the black man, Barnett asked sarcastically, "Which one of you is Meredith?" The rabble-rousing Edwin Walker, the retired Dallas general, had been among the military troops that Eisenhower had dispatched to Little Rock to enforce integration 5 years earlier. Now he was telling followers that he was on the right side. In vitriolic language on a Louisiana radio station, he told listeners, "We have listened and waited and been pushed around too long by the Antichrist Supreme Court. It is time to move. 10,000 strong from every state in the Union, rally to the cause of freedom, descend on Oxford and stand with the governor. Bring your flag, your tent, and your skillet." Asked if the volunteers should bring guns, Walker said that would be left to the individuals. Walker's crackpot views would have been laughable, but he was dead serious. I drove all night and pulled into Oxford on Sunday afternoon. The red and white panel truck with radio antennas whipping in the wind and KXOL, the station that pioneered and developed on-the-scene news coverage in the Great Southwest, emblazoned across its sides, was quite a sight for its day. It had drawn appreciative honks and waves, or at least I thought they were appreciative, along the highway and when I had stopped for gas. But there were no cheers in Oxford. Rough-looking gangs of men were roaming the streets, and as I tried to make my way through them, they booed and shouted, "Go home, nigger lover." Suddenly, I was under attack. Rocks and what appeared to be the weapon of choice, long-necked beer bottles, hit the sides of my truck with thuds. I couldn't believe it. Having announced no allegiance, I assumed a truck with Texas splashed across its sides would have received a friendlier greeting. But this mob didn't seem all that impressed with the station that pioneered and developed on-the-scene news coverage. To them, I was an outsider. I retreated to a calmer place, hoisted the suitcase-sized tape recorder from the back of the truck, and made my way on foot to find Bruce, who'd left word he was somewhere near the campus. I found him easily enough, but the next 12 hours would be among the most terrifying experiences of my life. There would be close calls in the future in Vietnam, but nothing like the terror I felt that night on the campus of Ole Miss. We had no idea when Meredith was to be enrolled. There were reports he would be brought to the campus the following morning, but it was obvious something was about to happen. The center of the Ole Miss campus is a beautiful grassy area. The main gate to the campus is situated at one end. Brick dormitory buildings line its sides, and at the far end sits the school administration building called the Lyceum, a lovely brick structure with six white columns across its front. Bruce and I had wandered to the Lyceum and were making idle talk with the students. They were friendly enough, but when word spread that federal marshals were on the way, the crowd began to swell, and it was obvious that the new additions were not all students. Within minutes, the crowd grew to several hundred people. Most of them seemed more curious than angry, but I did see several of the hooligans who had pelted my truck. A convoy of military vehicles turned from the highway and onto the campus, and when the students saw them, the mood changed. Still, the crowd was not altogether unfriendly. Like us, the students didn't know what was happening, and had come out to see what the commotion was all about. The trucks drove on to the Lyceum building, and more than 100 helmeted men, the marshals we had been told about, emerged from the trucks and took positions around the building. They carried clubs, and some had tear gas guns. Within an hour, another convoy had brought more marshals, a force that Bruce and I estimated to be around 300. By now, 500 or 600 students and townspeople were milling about, and at one incongruous moment, they chanted football yells. Then we heard it. From the main gate behind us, there was a sudden scream, and it was no football yell. This was a scream of pure hatred, and it came rolling toward us, growing louder, a cascade of screams and boos. Rumors had spread through the crowd that Meredith had been brought onto the campus. What had been a swarm of curious students had become an angry, screaming mob. The rumors were right. Meredith was being brought in. Marshals had originally planned to bring him onto the campus the following Monday morning. What was not known publicly was that Governor Barnett had been talking by telephone with Attorney General Robert Kennedy. Barnett suggested Meredith be brought onto the campus secretly on Sunday night. That way, Barnett had told Kennedy, Mississippi officials could claim they had been blindsided and could not be blamed for Meredith's presence. Kennedy took Barnett's advice, and marshals brought Meredith into one of the dorms, Baxter Hall, by a back road. Seeing the marshals surrounding the Lyceum, the crowds mistakenly thought that Meredith was there. At first, they shouted jeers and insults, then pelted the marshals with rocks and bottles and several Molotov cocktails, gasoline-filled bottles that exploded on impact. What triggered the first violence remains in dispute. At the time, Mississippi officials blamed it on provocative actions of inexperienced marshals. And in fact, when the marshals responded to the pelting with the first rounds of tear gas, a canister struck the back of a highway patrolman who was trying to push the mob back. As night closed in on the campus, the marshals fired tear gas again and again into the mob, and through the early evening managed to hold their own. Then, without warning, the state patrolmen who had been ringing the campus returned to their patrol cars and drove away, and a rougher crowd poured onto the campus. What police call a situation became a war, and the area around the Lyceum the main battleground. What those of us caught on campus wouldn't know until the next day was that as President Kennedy had gone on television that evening to report that Meredith had been brought on campus to be enrolled, he was unaware that the riot had broken out and that the Lyceum was already under siege. The first tear gas was apparently fired as he began his speech. From the fringe of the crowd, Bruce and I watched a grim pattern develop. Groups of people would form behind men waving Confederate flags and charge the marshals, throwing rocks and bottles. The marshals would drive them back with tear gas, and then another mob would form and charge again. Before it ended, two people would be killed, 166 marshals would be injured, one of them shot through the neck by a sniper. At least 40 soldiers would be hurt, and 200 people would be arrested. William Gagin, a young Justice Department lawyer who had been left to man Kennedy's secure phone line at the Justice Department when the Attorney General moved to the White House to set up a Washington command post, told me the afternoon had been as confusing in Washington as it had been on the Oxford campus. We kept getting reports from our people that the Mississippi Highway Patrol had left the campus. Then the White House would get a report from the Highway Patrol or the governor that they were still there, he said. It was total bedlam. And that night, when the president decided he had no alternative but to send in federal troops to restore order, it was so disorganized we couldn't get the troops to move. The troops had been flown to the Naval Air Station near Memphis, but orders for them to move would be given and then countermanded. No one seemed to know what was going on. Finally, the president sent word to tell the Army to get those troops to Oxford now. For years, there have been questions about what took the Army so long to get to Oxford from Memphis, and nearly four decades later, as I was doing research for this book, I uncovered one factor. Incredibly, the first troops to arrive in Memphis had no idea how to get to Oxford. Washington lawyer Henry T. Gallagher was a 23-year-old second lieutenant in the 716th Military Police Battalion that had been flown to the Naval Air Station near Memphis that Sunday morning. When the first federal troops were dispatched to Oxford after the rioting began, Gallagher was told to lead the 100 military vehicle convoy. "The problem was we didn't know where it was, and we had no maps," Gallagher told me. "There was a Navy guy on the front gate as we drove out, so I asked him if he knew where it was. He said he did, and he had a southern accent, so I figured he was telling the truth. I ordered him to get in the Jeep. He didn't want to go, but I told him I was acting on orders of the president, and he got in. Once we were out on the highway, I pulled into a Phillips 66 station and got a map. That's how we knew where to go." Gallagher said the entire afternoon had been one of total confusion. First, they sent orders telling us not to take ammunition to Oxford. Then they reversed that and told us not to leave without ammunition. Then, when we asked if the Mississippi Highway Patrol was with us or against us, we were told their loyalty was uncertain, and they gave us authority to shoot their dogs if they attacked us. The worst thing was they pulled our black guys out of the ranks and told them they had to stay in Memphis. It really hurt morale. One of our sergeants said he was refusing to step down, and we had to get one of the black officers to intervene. It was well past midnight when Gallagher and his troops finally got there, and others would begin to arrive within the hour. Once the federal troops were deployed, order was finally restored. Gagin told me Bobby Kennedy didn't want to send federal troops. Gagin said Kennedy thought the uniforms would remind everyone of the Union Army occupation after the Civil War, and that's why he put together that force of marshals in civilian clothes. "What we learned," Gagin said, "was that the people of Mississippi respected the military uniforms and were much more reluctant to attack the federal troops than the marshals." That the soldiers were carrying loaded military carbines may have also been a factor. In any case, the marshals had managed to keep the mob at bay until the federal troops arrived. The most terrifying part of the evening for Bruce and me had come earlier when a sniper opened fire from a dorm roof. I had spent the three previous years in the Air Force and never heard a shot fired in anger. Now, 2 weeks out of the Air Force, I thought someone was shooting at me. I hit the dirt as a bullet whistled by, but it was apparently aimed far from me. Other shots cracked through the night. Lights were shot out. An Associated Press newsman was wounded when hit by birdshot fired from another gun. In one of the evening's more bizarre episodes, students commandeered a bulldozer from the nearby construction site, revved the motor to full throttle, and drove it toward the Lyceum and jumped clear. Fortunately, the huge machine stalled and no damage was done. Other students brought a fire truck onto the campus and were unfurling fire hoses across the grounds and using the truck as a moving platform from which to throw rocks. By this time, most of the streetlights had been shot out or broken by rocks. The rioters had brought in cans of gasoline and were beginning to torch parked vehicles. The acrid smell of burning rubber cut into the tear gas that hung over the Lyceum lawn, and with the only light coming from the glow of the burning cars, the area took on an eerie orange cast. I watched as Gordon Yoder, an NBC cameraman from Dallas, was pulled from his car before the mob torched it. I was still lugging the enormous suitcase-sized tape recorder, and when I tried to record some of the sound, the crowd turned on me. I was pushed back into a tree and fell, but a noise diverted the crowd's attention and no one harmed me as I lay on the ground. Toward midnight, Bruce and I had had enough. We were covering the story of our lives, but we hadn't called in a report in hours and we were choking on tear gas. The sound of sniper fire overhead may have also had something to do with our decision to take a break. In any case, we retreated to safer territory, filed our reports, and when we returned, the campus had been sealed off by the federal troops. We got back onto the campus at daybreak to find a scene out of a World War II movie. The Lyceum looked like the German headquarters after the GIs had stormed it. Burned-out cars littered the grounds. We got there in time to see the marshals escort Meredith from Baxter Hall to the Lyceum, where he was formally registered for class. I got close enough to shout a question, but he looked straight ahead and gave no sign of hearing me. What struck me was how perfectly groomed he looked that morning and what a striking contrast he was to the wire service reporter who was jogging beside him trying to ask a question. The wire service man was wearing a pork pie straw hat, slacks, and a seersucker blazer. But somehow in the confusion of the night, he had lost his shirt. Only a hairy chest showed beneath his coat. More than 16,000 troops had taken up positions on campus overnight. Later in the week, the number of troops in Oxford would grow to more than 24,000, and the town of 10,000 residents was turned into a military fort. But the court orders had been carried out, and Meredith had been enrolled. If I had not understood before what blacks were going through in the South, I was beginning to understand now. Live gunfire has a way of bringing abstract arguments into sharper focus. Meredith attended two classes that day, one in colonial American history, the other in Spanish, and was correctly, if not warmly, received. But the only official recognition of his presence was a notice posted on the door of the trustees' conference room that read, "Pursuant to the mandate of the federal courts, the orders for the registration of Meredith have been followed." Meredith was a 27-year-old Air Force veteran when he decided to transfer from Jackson State to Ole Miss to complete his college work. As historian Richard Reeves would later write, the Kennedy administration had been dubious about supporting him in the beginning. Kennedy had his hands full with the Soviet buildup in Cuba, and November midterm elections were 6 weeks away. He had no interest in a civil rights blow-up just then, but as he would later tell Governor Ross Barnett in one of those secret phone calls, "I don't have the power to call off Meredith." Nor did he, and one reason federal officials finally decided to back Meredith was his age and the fact that he had done well at Jackson State and would need only 1 year on campus to graduate. Second Lieutenant Gallagher, who had led those first federal soldiers onto the campus, became chief of Meredith's guard detail and remained on the campus until spring. Governor Barnett spent the next year trying to block Meredith's graduation, but despite that, and despite the fact that Meredith never left his dorm without his security detail, he was a model student and graduated on time. His graduation became a turning point in the civil rights movement, but his own life later took a strange twist. He declared himself to be a conservative Republican and at one point endorsed former Ku Klux Klan leader David Duke's candidacy for president. Neither of the men who died the night Meredith was brought to Ole Miss had been participants in the battle. One was a jukebox repairman who had been hit by a stray bullet when he had come from behind a building to see what had caused all the noise. The other fatality was Paul Giard, a French press agency reporter and budding playwright based in New York. He had been sent to Oxford on his day off because the bureau was shorthanded. Earlier that year, Giard's first play, a one-act comedy, had been produced in an off-Broadway theater. It was a story about a shipwrecked sailor who lands on what he thinks is a deserted island only to discover a deck chair there and a policeman who has no one to police. The policeman won't let the man sit in the deck chair because it is against the island rules, and they argue. Then a tidal wave sweeps the chair and both men away. A friend said Giard meant the play to be about man's revolt against the absurdity of life. Giard was 29 when he wrote it, 30 when he died on the Oxford campus, shot in the back. Kennedy, despite initial fears that the situation in Oxford would harm him politically, went up in the polls. Chapter 4, The Night Beat. As I look back on Meredith's enrollment, the most incredible part to me is that Kennedy dealt with it in the midst of the Cuban Missile Crisis. Over the years, countless stories have been written about how the two superpowers came so close to nuclear war in those tense weeks, but it was not until Kennedy went on television the night of October 22nd that we really understood the gravity of the situation. As for Meredith, once he began attending classes, the story was over for me. I drove the mobile unit back to Fort Worth and settled into a routine of covering wrecks and murders. But the Cuban situation was always in the background and continued to get more and more play in the papers. We had known something was going on in Cuba, but we had no idea it would be anything as serious or as threatening as what Kennedy told us in the October 22nd television address. That there were missiles 90 miles offshore with the range to drop nuclear bombs on every American population center except Seattle. He told us that American ships had already blockaded Cuba and would enforce a quarantine on offensive weapons. In the most ominous passage, he warned the Soviets that should these offensive military preparations continue, thus increasing the threat to this hemisphere, further action will be justified. I have directed the armed forces to prepare for any eventuality. This was it. We had heard our president threaten to go to war, and we understood that meant nuclear war. The next week would see a blizzard of events unlike anything that America had experienced since World War II. And to those of us who had grown up in Fort Worth, we understood this was not a war that would be fought in some faraway place. Our Carswell Air Force Base was home to the Strategic Air Command, the American strike force of long-range nuclear bombers. As kids, we had taken some hometown pride in knowing that if war ever came, our hometown was so important we would be a priority target, a point of pride that did not seem nearly so important once we understood that war was a real possibility. In New York, Ambassador Adlai Stevenson pilloried his Soviet counterpart with questions about the buildup, a fact the Soviet man refused to confirm even when confronted with the photos. In Moscow, the Soviet press blamed it all on American warmongers. Official and unofficial emissaries carried secret messages between world capitals. In Fort Worth, we bought extra canned goods and talked of the best escape routes if war came. In public, neither side was backing off. But as we would later learn, Khrushchev was secretly writing a long, rambling personal letter to Kennedy that proposed a way out. If the United States would pledge not to invade Cuba, the question of armaments would disappear, since if there is no threat, then armaments are a burden for every people. The next day, the Soviets publicly released a more strongly worded message that proposed removing the missiles in Cuba only if the United States removed the missiles it had installed during the Eisenhower administration along the Soviet border in Turkey. Kennedy weighed both messages and decided to answer the private one. He made no specific mention of the Turkish missiles, but said the reduction of tension that would come about with the removal of the missiles in Cuba would enable us to work toward a more general arrangement regarding other armaments. He released the message publicly on the Voice of America, and that night, a Saturday, he signed an order mobilizing 140,000 Air Force reservists and went to bed. With the rest of the world, he waited for Khrushchev's reply. By chance, I was working the early shift at KXOL the following day when the crisis finally ended. Sunday was normally my day off, but I had traded shifts with another reporter and got to the newsroom early. Sunday morning was the one time of the week when we deviated from our strict format of rock and roll records and 5 minutes of news on the hour and half hour. Sunday mornings were set aside for religious broadcasts, the one time of the week we could not, under any circumstances, sound the siren and break in with news bulletins. Our star Sunday attraction was the Reverend Charles R. Jones, pastor of Bethel Temple, an evangelical church on Fort Worth's east side. His 30-minute program mixed calls to repentance with recorded gospel music and occasional interviews with guest speakers who appeared at his church from week to week. His guests ranged from reformed alcoholics who had seen the light to a man who claimed to have memorized the entire good book, and he modestly called himself the Walking Bible. The Reverend Jones had no guests that Sunday, however, and I had the volume on our on-the-air monitor turned low and was reading the newspaper about Kennedy's latest offer when the bulletin bell dinged on the Associated Press wire machine behind me. I had hardly turned around as the machine began to print out, "Bulletin, Soviets agree to dismantle missiles." Subsequent paragraphs explained that Radio Moscow had reported that Khrushchev had notified Kennedy that work would be stopped on the missile sites and the weapons dismantled if the United States pledged not to attack Cuba. Rules or no rules, I had to break into Reverend Jones' program and report the news. The crisis was over. We were not going to war. I buzzed him over the intercom and told him I had to break in immediately with news that just couldn't wait, and I put the bulletin on the air. "Well, praise the Lord," the Reverend said as I turned off my mic. If my memory is not playing tricks, I think I actually responded, "Amen." For the first time in weeks, tensions relaxed, and shortly after, my own life would take an unexpected turn. Phil Record, the Star-Telegram's night shift police reporter, was being promoted to night city editor. He wondered if I would be interested in taking his place covering the night police beat for the paper. It took me about 30 seconds to say yes. If you lived in Fort Worth and wanted to be a reporter, the Star-Telegram was your goal. Fort Worth was still a two-newspaper town then. The Scripps Howard chain operated a tabloid afternoon paper called the Fort Worth Press. It had a fine sports department that included future novelists Dan Jenkins, Edwin Schrake, and Gary Cartwright, as well as the legendary Blackie Sherrod, who became the model for one of the characters in Jenkins' book Semi-Tough. The Press also had some crack police reporters, Harold Williams and Jack Mosley, and gave the Star-Telegram fierce competition on the news beats. But for the most part, it was a ragtag operation that couldn't match the well-financed Star-Telegram, which was packed with ads and had twice as many reporters. The Star-Telegram was owned by the Amon Carter family. Carter was a multimillionaire who had made his first money selling chicken sandwiches along the tracks of a railway station in the North Texas town of Bowie. He parlayed those early dollars into a financial empire built around the Star-Telegram, a radio and television station, a large stake in American Airlines, and a multitude of other businesses. He became a confidant of FDR, Eisenhower, Lindbergh, and Will Rogers, and even his enemies conceded that he ran Fort Worth. No project happened there without his blessing, and with his help, all things seemed possible. One year, during the Gridiron Show, an evening of satire put on by local journalists, a reporter playing Fort Worth Mayor Edgar Dean had only one line. Each time a voice from offstage would call out, "Edgar," he would dutifully answer, "Coming, Amon." That more or less summed up the relationship between Carter and Fort Worth. Carter envisioned the newspaper first as a vehicle to promote Fort Worth and West Texas, and second, as well, a newspaper. But it was still the best paper in town and on a par with the better southern newspapers of its day. Carter died before I came to the paper, but his son Amon Jr. and daughter Ruth continued to run it in his spirit. For a reporter, working at the Star-Telegram carried such prestige that I thought nothing of going to work there for $115 a week, $20 less than I made at the radio station. I had taken the job at KXOL because the news director was willing to take a chance on someone with no experience, but I had never thought of broadcasting as a career. So when Phil cleared the way, I gave a week's notice and reported to the Star-Telegram for work. The pay may have been lousy and the hours even worse, 6 p.m. to 2 a.m., but I would be replacing the man who had become my role model, Phil the Hat Record. Phil was known as the Hat because he always wore a felt snap brim. It was the standard uniform for police reporters for one reason. It made it easier for them to pass themselves off as detectives. We had an informal code of ethics then. We never lied about who we were, but if people mistook us for the police, that was their problem, not ours. If they thought they were giving confidential information to an investigator, well, that was their problem too. As we understood the First Amendment, everyone had a right to talk to the Star-Telegram, even if they didn't know they were talking to the Star-Telegram. At KXOL, we had learned by doing, but at the Star-Telegram, I would have a chance to learn from people who knew more about reporting than I did. It was Phil who would teach me how to capture the essence of a story in the lead sentence, how to cover a beat, and, the most important thing a reporter needs to know, how to listen. On every beat I ever worked, there was always one reporter like Phil the Hat, who set the tone, had the best sources, knew the historical context for every story, and framed the unwritten rules the other reporters followed. Phil looked more like a cop than Dick Tracy, and the first thing he told me to do was get a hat. Phil's hat had become such a trademark that when he freelanced articles in True Crime magazine, he wrote under the name Ellie Chapeau. He believed the first rule of reporting was to blend in. Looking like you belonged would get you into most places, he told me, and when Kennedy was shot, I would understand how right he was. The detectives, we call them dicks, which is what they call themselves, all wore felt snap brims. Because they did, Phil did. And because Phil did, I did. Every new reporter gets a certain amount of hazing, but Phil let the cops know I was his guy and I was soon accepted. I realized it the night I came barreling around a corner near the dispatcher's office and thought I'd been attacked by a dog. I felt a tugging at my ankle and heard a sharp arf, arf, arf. In fact, it was not a dog, but Detective Captain Chick Matlock, whose favorite trick was to sneak up behind an unsuspecting person, grab an ankle, and bark. It seemed odd to me, but when I told Phil about it, he said, "Oh, that just means you're one of the guys now. Don't blow it."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.